Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You may know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled The Teachings of Jesus. This is number 11 in that series on the Sabbath. It's a lesson that we'll be studying worldwide on September 13 of 2014. I think you'll find this lesson very interesting and challenging, and I hope you'll stay by. Hope you have your Bible handy as well. There's a lot of text to look at, but let's begin with a word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, once again it is our privilege to gather together here to think about you, to talk about you, and to learn about you from Scripture. May this time together be a blessing to all who tune in, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, what was Christ's role relative to the Sabbath, its origin, what he taught about it when he was here on this earth? Did he keep the Sabbath himself? And what did his followers do after his death? Because that seems to be a big issue today when people worship on other days. One of the most potent texts for all of this, and sort of a key text, is the one that's our memory verse for this week, and is found in Mark 2, 27 and 28. I'm sure you're all very familiar with it. And Jesus concluded, "The Sabbath was made for the good of human beings. They were not made for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." So that sort of really, to a considerable extent, summarizes what we're going to be able to study, what we're going to talk about in this lesson. He said something similar to that also in Matthew and Luke. Well, as you know, in our day, it's not just a question of how you keep the Sabbath, but it's also a question of which day is the correct day for the true Sabbath day, the day that God intends for us to keep. Now, it's pretty clear, if you've carefully studied the Gospels, that there's no support in the Gospels for anything like observing any day except what we call the Sabbath, what in Spanish is called Sabado, and other languages something similar. We call it Saturday. In fact, we would like to propose that there's no support for keeping any other day in any part of Scripture. Well, it's pretty clear that the first Sabbath occurred when? The end of that first week of creation. In Genesis 2, verses 2 and 3, it says, it describes it like this: "By the seventh day, God finished what he had been doing and stopped working. He blessed the seventh day and set it apart as a special day, because by that day he had completed his creation and stopped working." That's pretty straightforward, pretty simple. And unfortunately, my computer program decided it was time to stop just then. Give me just a second and we'll move on here.
For people who think the creation one day is 1,000 years instead of one day, what do they think about Jesus stopping, finishing creation, and then saying, "Let's rest"? Do they?
Well, are you saying, do they think we should rest for 1,000 years? There are people who believe that the history of our world has been 6,000 years, and so now we're ready to enter the seventh millennium, and this should be the time of rest. There are people who believe that that's what the millennium, in spoken of in Revelation 20, is supposed to be. It's the Sabbath of the history of our world. But there's no support for that either.
If one did away with the 7 days, 7 24-hour days of creation, one could also say that you do away with the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, basically, yeah. Well, we would like to make it very clear, and based on several verses, let's look at a couple of them. Look at John 1, verses 1 to 3. And what we want to make clear is that Jesus was the creator of the entire universe, of everything seen and unseen, including the Sabbath. And I quote from John 1:1-3, "In the beginning the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. From the very beginning the Word was with God. Through Him God made all things, not one thing in all creation was made without Him." So that's pretty compelling, I think. And look at some other places. Look at Colossians 1:16. "For through Him God created everything in heaven, on earth, the seen and the unseen things." Would Sabbath be a seen or an unseen thing?
Unseen.
An unseen thing. "Including spiritual powers, lords, rulers, and authorities. God created the whole universe through Him and for Him."
Now, Him means Jesus.
Jesus, yeah.
And the Word is another name for Jesus?
Yes. Yeah. And then in Hebrews 1, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors many times and in many ways through the prophets. But in these last days, He has spoken to us through His Son. He is the one through whom God created the universe, the one whom God has chosen to possess all things at the end. He reflects the brightness of God's glory and His exact likeness of God's own being, sustaining the universe with His powerful word. After achieving forgiveness for human sins, He sat down in heaven at the right-hand side of God, the supreme power." So there's three passages. We could read others, but it's very clear from these passages that Jesus created how much?
Everything.
Everything. Animate and inanimate. The entire universe, including the Sabbath, was created by Him. Now, we need to be honest with the evidence. Our seventh day is a function of our planetary system, our solar system, our world, and how fast we spin around and so forth. So people in other parts of the universe probably have other days in which they celebrate a so-called Sabbath. But this particular Sabbath is our Sabbath. Now, what's going to be the future home of God?
This earth.
This earth. And we'll be lighted by His glory, I'm sure. We won't need to sleep at night. There'll be times when we'll be away from the sun, presumably. I don't know exactly. I presume that'll be true. But yet, we will have times when the sun's there and times when the sun's not there. So there will be days and technically nights, whatever that means. In the world made new. Well, and this is Ellen White's comment on from Desire of Ages, page 288, paragraph 2. "Because the Sabbath was made for man, it is the Lord's day. It belongs to Christ. For all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made," John 1:3. "Since He made all things, He made the Sabbath. By Him it was set apart as a memorial of the work of creation. It points to Him as both the Creator and the Sanctifier. Then the Sabbath is a sign of Christ's power to make us holy, and it is given to all whom Christ makes holy. As a sign of His sanctifying power, the Sabbath was given to all who through Christ become a part of the Israel of God."
Now, how does the Sabbath show Christ's sanctifying power?
Well,
I can see He made it His day.
Mm-hmm. What she's trying to suggest, I think, is that He has the power to change us, to make us new, and that would be sanctifying. So He is, as a creator, He has the power to do that. So why did God make the Sabbath? God didn't need to rest, did He?
No.
And it certainly wasn't, I mean, there's some people who suggest, well, man, when he came to this earth, he just worked for 6 days and it was time for him to rest. Well, if that was really the case, we should be worshiping on Thursday. Because man was created on Friday, right? So that's not a very good argument either. So the Sabbath is much more than just a day of rest. What is it supposed to be?
Time for education, learning, study.
It's a time for us to set aside our worries and cares and responsibilities of the rest of the week and spend that time with our family, with God, with other church members and so forth. Well, the next time that the Sabbath is mentioned in Scripture is when?
The Exodus.
The Exodus, which of course, this is a time when God does a number of miraculous things in order to get His children of Israel out of Egypt. He takes them to Mount Sinai, and one of the very first things He does is say, here's the Ten Commandments. And right in the heart of those Ten Commandments is the seventh-day Sabbath. That, of course, is repeated by Moses later, and as they're approaching the entry to the land of Canaan itself in Deuteronomy 5, with a slightly different reason for keeping the Sabbath. But so we now have seen that Sabbath is associated with God's creation. We have seen that we see that the Sabbath is associated with His redemption. He actually redeemed the children of Israel. He rescued them from Egyptian slavery, right?
So He created man in the beginning, and then at the Exodus He gave him freedom, kind of recreated him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. There was a lot of problems connected to this about the Sabbath, over the Sabbath, let's say, in the days of the Babylonian captivity. And why would that be?
They were slaves.
Yeah, basically, the rulers in Babylon expected them to worship what god?
Babylon.
What evidence do we have for that?
Daniel.
Okay, in the book of Daniel, we have the plain of Dura. What happened on the plain of Dura? The great statue that was all gold and supposed to represent Nebuchadnezzar? Bow down. You've got to bow down, otherwise we'll burn you up, right? Plain of Dura. Another example. The next kingdom, Medo-Persia. What happened?
Daniel praying to his god instead of the emperor.
Exactly, and you get thrown in the lion's den, right? So how do you carefully and prayerfully and thoughtfully keep worshiping the true God under those kind of pressures? Well, Isaiah 66:23, let's skip over the New Testament times right now. Isaiah 66:23 tells us what? On every new moon festival and every Sabbath, the people of every nation will come. Now, this is talking about the new heavens and the new earth, if you go back and look up a few verses. Will come to worship me here in Jerusalem, says the Lord. So, we're apparently going to continue worshiping on Sabbath for the rest of eternity.
Why does it irritate people when other people worship on the Sabbath? I mean, in Babylon captivity, why would they even care if you were doing something with your God, if they didn't even recognize that God? I mean, why did that make them mad? It seems like you could just say, oh, okay, do your thing, and you know.
No, the real reason is this. When you show allegiance to another God, you are not under their control.
If I may?
Yeah.
Okay. Also, the Sabbath gave even the slave a day of rest, and which was, you know, they did not want that. They wanted to just keep working and working and working, and it did some practical things as well. People moved that even into the earth. You know, you work for so much and then you give it rest for after 7 years or whatever, and people incorporated this thing into their everyday lives. But people just wanted the slaves to keep working and working. If they die there, you just move and keep going. They have to rethink a few things.
Yeah. Well, now let's look into the New Testament and the Gospels. We're talking this quarter about the teachings of Jesus, so we're focusing particularly on the Gospels. What did Jesus teach about the Sabbath? Matthew 12. Not long afterwards, Jesus was walking through some cornfields on the Sabbath. Now, it's not clear in the original Greek whether this is talking about corn as spoken of in British circles, meaning wheat, or whether it's talking about corn as spoken of in America, which refers to maize, as the British would call it. But it's pretty clear from the comments that this is probably wheat growing. And they picked some of this wheat, they rubbed it in their hands and knocked off the husks and so forth, blew away the chaff, and started chewing on the kernels of wheat. Okay, this is what was happening. Very serious sin, right?
It was harvesting, thrashing, and winnowing.
Oh, dear. Harvesting, thrashing, and winnowing, those are things that are absolutely forbidden. Those are forms of work, right?
I have a question, but maybe a nutritionist is not with us. That always puzzled me, because in the Adventist literature, I always read that you're not supposed to eat raw grains, that you're supposed to cook them. And even like Agatha Thrash, she says, cook them a long time. But here in the Bible, Jesus and his disciples are eating them raw.
Yes.
So,
well, there are definitely advantages to cooking grains. The most obvious one is that they're a lot easier to eat. You know,
when you take a wheat off of this stock like that, we used to do it as kids.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Up, and it's chewy. It's not the same as the dried wheat we think of to make bread and
yeah. But I love this raw granola, and I've always ate it, and it just made me feel guilty that, you know, so. Anyway, so you haven't heard anything other than...
Not that I'm aware, no problems with it.
Okay.
Of course, though, it shouldn't be eaten by people who are allergic to gluten.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, what was the problem? Well, a couple things we need to make very clear. Deuteronomy 23:25 says, and I quote, "When you walk along a path in someone else's cornfield, you may eat all the corn you can pull off with your hands, but you must not cut any corn with a sickle." In other words, help yourself, but don't take any of it home. Okay?
In other words, the disciples weren't stealing this grain.
This is perfectly acceptable any other day of the week except Sabbath. So what was the problem with doing it on Sabbath?
The regulations.
Well, how did Jesus respond when they questioned the behavior of the disciples? He said some things that were interesting and things which I have wondered for long years and years. What in the world was he talking about? Well, let's just see if we can figure these out. There are three important points to be made in his answer to the Pharisees. One, just as David and his men were fed by the loaves from the tabernacle, remember, they were given the holy bread from the tabernacle, which is supposed to be eaten only by the priests, we can be assured that God is concerned about even our simplest needs and wants. So, if someone is seriously hungry, God will make provision for them to eat, even if it's, quote, forbidden bread, right? That would be the first point. The second point, the priests in Jesus' day, like pastors in our day, didn't do more work on the Sabbath than they do on any other day. And we bless them for doing this, don't we? We appreciate it. But there's another interesting, very subtle point, and that's this. When David was running away from Saul and his men were pursuing after him to try to avoid being killed themselves, David had already been what?
Anointed.
Samuel had already come and anointed him as the next king. Okay? But was he already enthroned as a king?
No.
Certainly he wasn't. Saul was trying to kill him so he couldn't be enthroned as a king. Well, in Christ's day, is there a parallel?
Had Jesus. Christ been anointed?
Yeah,
at the baptism.
At his baptism, by the Father and by the Holy Spirit. So here's Christ has already been anointed. Has he been enthroned?
No.
Not yet. So there's a parallel between David's situation and Christ's situation. They both had been anointed, but neither one had yet been enthroned.
And they both were under distress and they needed food.
Trying to be destroyed by the current authorities. Yeah.
I'd never seen that before.
Interesting, huh? Well, another story about this very famous story about Jesus keeping the Sabbath is found in Luke 4, verses 16 through 30. We won't take time to read the whole thing. But then Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath he went as usual to the synagogue. What does that imply?
Something he did all the time.
Yes.
Something he did all the time. A good Jew was expected to do that. He stood up to read the scriptures and was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has chosen me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free the oppressed and announce that the time has come when the Lord will save his people." Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. Now, what's going on here?
He didn't read the last verse.
the next phrase.
The next phrase, yes.
There's two very, well, first of all, we need to understand, what was the normal practice in synagogues?
They stood up to read the scripture, and then the preacher, we can say, of the day, sat down to discuss it.
Yeah, the scroll was much too precious to set out during the entire service. So you'd roll the scroll carefully back up, put it away in its safe spot, and then someone would be responsible for doing that. Then the person who was responsible for giving the presentation would say, sit down, okay, now let me tell you what we're supposed to learn from what we just read. Okay? Now, it turns out that this passage in Isaiah 61 was recognized by all the Jews as what?
Prophecy of the Messiah.
A prophecy of the Messiah. And why do why were they always excited about this prophecy of the Messiah?
Because of the next four words.
Which said?
And defeat their enemies.
And defeat their enemies. Exactly. They were looking for the Messiah to show up to defeat their enemies. That's what the Messiah was supposed to do. And here's the proof of it in Scripture.
Why did Jesus stop when the Lord will save his people?
You weren't supposed to say that. I was supposed to ask that question.
Oh.
Okay, why did he stop?
Because he didn't come to defeat their earthly enemies.
So why would he? Why did it say that back in Isaiah?
That's what I was going to ask.
Yeah. Okay. We're together here today.
Gordon, he said earthly enemies, but the verse doesn't say earthly or non-earthly enemies. It just says your enemies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Isaiah kept going, but Jesus stopped.
Yeah.
So they interpret it as their earthly enemies. Maybe it was really Isaiah wrote it as Lucifer.
In the larger context, Isaiah is talking about defeating all our enemies until we enter the new kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, and enter the new earth. So he's talking about our ultimate enemies, and of course that would be primarily Satan and all his hordes. But they wanted, who did they think were the enemies?
The Romans.
Yeah, they wanted to get rid of the Romans. And so what did Jesus do?
He turned their paradigm on its head, or tried
to. Oh dear. And let's just mention one or two other things here before we get to the punchline. Look at these words from Ellen White, Desire of Ages, page 74, talking about his early childhood, in youth. Often, in the synagogue, on the Sabbath day, he was called upon to read the lesson from the prophets. He's still a young kid. And the hearts of the hearers thrilled as a new light shone out from the familiar words of the sacred text. What does that suggest?
People thought he was inspiring as he read.
And he read things in a way that made it opened up and helped them to understand something they hadn't understood before. Even as a young person, he was doing this. Well, what did they expect Jesus to do before we come to the conclusion? What did they expect him to do when he came home to Nazareth?
You mean as
the people of Nazareth there, Jesus comes home, they invite him to speak in the synagogue, and what do they expect to see happen?
Do they think he's a man, a prophet, or the Messiah? What do they
They expect miracles.
Yeah, they said, man, we hear that this guy has performed lots of miracles in all kinds of other places, he's healed the sick, etc. Okay, what's he going to do when he comes home?
Going to heal all our diseases.
Exactly.
Raise people, maybe even.
Yeah. Well, and what did Jesus do?
Well, he extended it even further. He said, also, intimated the influence was to go abroad.
Yes.
And once he got into that, the Gentiles. Yes. That
boy, he's the idea that the Messiah could actually show up on planet Earth and bless Canaanites and Syrians in place of Israelites. Oh man, those are fighting words.
Now, where do you get that? That's from Jesus's reference to
the story of Naaman, the widow of Zarephath, and the story of Naaman the Syrian.
Elijah. Elijah and Elisha.
Go back to his hometown. They were expecting miracles, and they wanted him to do the miracles that he had done in other places. So what did Jesus do?
Well, Jesus didn't perform any miracles there. He said the Messiah has, basically he said, the Messiah is here. He said, this day have these words been fulfilled in your eyes. What's he saying?
I am the Messiah.
And I bless not only Jews, but I came to bless Gentiles. And they say, for that you ought to be stoned. Or thrown off the cliff. We know what the Messiah is supposed to do, and you're not doing it. See? They didn't want to give the Messiah the opportunity to say what the Messiah should do. Well,
they were not willing learners and listeners.
No, not at all.
And he miraculously disappeared from them before they could throw him off the cliff.
Yes. I had the privilege of visiting that place this last summer, and they took us up to that cliff, and it is a straight off fall, yeah, for a long ways down. So potentially they certainly could have thrown him down. Well, what should we learn about the Sabbath from studying Jesus' miracles that he performed on the Sabbath? Can you mention some miracles that were performed on the Sabbath?
The Pool of Bethesda.
Okay, well, yeah. Let me go to that one first.
Didn't it have mainly to do with sick and ailing people, what he did on the
Sure.
Sabbath?
Yes, but they weren't emergency situations.
Not emergencies, they are long-term sicknesses.
Okay,
could have been done any day.
John 5, after this Jesus went to Jerusalem for a religious festival. Near the sheep gate in Jerusalem there was a pool with five porches. In Hebrew it is called Bethzatha. Traditionally, it's called Bethesda, but it almost certainly was originally Bethzatha. A large crowd of sick people were lying in the porches, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. A man was there who had been ill for 38 years. Is this an emergency case?
No.
And you know, Jesus healed him and said, now he could have said, healed him and said, you know, this is a Sabbath, leave your mat there, you can go, you can come back and get your mat later. Well, what did Jesus say?
Pick up your mat.
Pick up your mat and carry it home with you. Oh dear. What's he telling him to do?
He's working.
Lots of bad things.
He's intentionally telling him to break their Sabbath rules. And to publicize the fact that he just healed a man who'd been sick for 38 years. And that, you want to publicize something, it's like telling somebody to drive down the street with a big old red flag waving over them, you know? Well, another experience, that happened on the Sabbath. Another experience, John 9, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been born blind. His disciples asked him, Teacher, whose sin caused him to be born blind? Was it his own or his parents' sin? And there was a big discussion, and Jesus, remember, took some spit on the ground, made a little sort of mud, rubbed it on his eyes, said, go to the Pool of Siloam. He went, and when he came back, people said, he looks like the guy who used to sit at the gate. And some said yes, and some said no. But I mean, he can see now, what happened? And of course, the case quickly came up before the Sanhedrin, and oh dear, dear.
Jesus could have made the man see just by speaking or just by putting his hand in front of him. So why did he have to pick up dirt and spit on it and put it on the man's eyes?
Good question.
Prove a point.
That was medicine in their thinking, and you weren't allowed to put medicine on above the neck.
The Sabbath?
Under certain circumstances, you could put medicine on below the neck, but you weren't allowed to put medicine on above the neck.
Okay,
on
so
Sabbath.
He specifically found a blind man who had an illness above the neck, mm-hmm. and specifically made a concoction.
A poultice
or above the head.
Yeah. Well, on the head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
On the head. Yeah.
So Jesus intentionally broke their rules, didn't he? He did mighty wonderful miracles, but he was intentionally breaking their rules. Another occasion, Matthew 12. he went into the synagogue where there was a man who had a paralyzed hand. Some people were there who wanted to accuse Jesus of doing wrong, so they asked him, "Is it against our law to heal on the Sabbath?" Jesus answered, "What if one of you has a sheep and it falls into a deep hole on the Sabbath? Will you not take hold of it and lift it out?" I mean, and what would they answer? What would they have to answer?
Of course. They have to relieve suffering of the animal.
Sure. And furthermore, preserve their monetary worth.
Yes.
And a human being is worth much more than a sheep. Anybody argue with that? No. So then our law does allow us to heal someone or help someone on the Sabbath. Then he said to the man with the paralyzed hand, "Stretch out your hand." And what happened?
He was healed.
He stretched it out and it became well again, just like the other one. Now, had he commanded the arm to be well? Had he done anything? You just said stretch. Is it against the law to stretch out your hand? No, it can't be against the law to stretch out your hand. Nothing wrong with that. But look at this. Then the Pharisees left and made plans to kill Jesus. Why would they do that?
He was interfering with the system.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Interfering with the system. So why do you think Jesus intentionally broke their Sabbath rules?
To make a point.
Which point?
Yeah.
Well, they were not correct rules.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Well, they were worshiping something other than God.
Yes.
They had burdened. Some people say there were 539 rules about Sabbath keeping. I've never tried to count them, but there were a lot of them. Try to imagine yourself living in the days of Jesus. How do you think you would have responded to their many rules about Sabbath keeping? Now, all of you have grown up in this terribly free society we call America, and you tend to be righteously indignant when someone limits your freedoms, right?
Yes.
So how would you feel about those rules, the Sabbath rules?
When you look at the whole situation, there were certain stratas of life that weren't thought of much more than a sheep.
Yeah.
And yet the priests, with all this mumbo jumbo, were held in awe.
Mm-hmm.
And they were so used to it that it was time somebody challenged it.
Mm-hmm.
I think the people looked up to their church leaders, and this is what their church leaders said was proper. And
yeah.
So the Pharisees and scribes were in positions of authority.
Well, okay, we need to move on in history, because we're trying to take a wide view of the situation. Did Jesus give any hints while he was still here on this earth about what should be done after he was dead? What about Matthew 24, verse 20? Now, Jesus is talking about the time of the destruction of Jerusalem. And he says, "Pray to God that you will not have to run away during the winter or on a Sabbath." Why would he say that?
If you kept the rules, you'd be lucky to get out on your own skin.
Yeah, it'd be hard to even get out of the city. All the gates would be closed and so forth. If you had to walk very far, you'd be accused of breaking the Sabbath because you walked too far, right?
I've heard it argued that because Jesus broke or went against the rules of the Sabbath at his time, he was saying the Sabbath will be changed to Sunday,
yeah,
or the Sabbath will be changed.
And you're going to read the verse that says that?
Absolutely not. I'm just saying what people have told me.
Okay, well, people have suggested that because of the resurrection of Jesus, which they regard as maybe the most important event in history, that we should worship on Sunday. Well, did any of the disciples start worshiping on Sunday as a result of that?
No.
Well, let's take Paul as an example. He's the one who has written the most historical material. We know most about his story. Look at Acts 13, verse 14. They went on from Perga and arrived in Antioch and Pisidia, and on the Sabbath they went into the synagogue and sat down. Pretty clear, right? They're still worshiping on the Sabbath. Look at verse 42 in the same chapter, Acts 13. as Paul and Barnabas were leaving the synagogue, the people invited them to come back the next Sabbath and tell them more about these things. Now, if they were supposed to be worshiping on Sunday, or someone was supposed to be suggesting a different worship day, wouldn't this have been a perfect time to say, well, you know, the synagogue's here all week long, why don't you come tomorrow? We'll talk about all these things tomorrow. No, they said, come when?
Sabbath day.
Next Sabbath. Well, take a couple more places. Look at Acts 14, verse 1. The same thing happened in Iconium. Paul and Barnabas went to the synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of Jews and Gentiles became believers. Where were they worshiping? In the synagogue. What time of the week do you worship in the synagogue?
Sabbath.
On Sabbath. Look at Acts 17, verses 1 and 2. Paul and Silas now, a different trip, traveled on through Amphipolis and Apollonia and came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue. According to his usual habit, what does that mean?
Does it all the time.
Paul went to the synagogue. There, during three Sabbaths, he held discussions with the people, quoting and explaining the scriptures and proving from them that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from death. Okay? So what was Paul's practice? One more, I guess. Acts 18, verse 4. He held discussions in the synagogue every Sabbath, trying to convince both Jews and Greeks. So it wasn't just the Jews that were there to listen to Paul's arguments.
So did the Greek people start coming to the synagogues on the Sabbath?
Yes. Yeah.
Now, Ken, I've heard that Sabbath and Sabbaths can be used as festival days.
There are in the Old Testament the days, for example, the new moons. Are regarded as Sabbaths. That is, they were times to rest. And so, technically, Sabbath means rest. So it could be a day of rest in the Jewish calendar, but nothing to replace the weekly Sabbath.
But there are those around, even in this general area, that now say that there's no such thing as one special day. Every day is a Sabbath. Mm-hmm. It ties into what you said.
I was listening to another church that's near me, and I thought, you know, maybe I'd like to go there. And the preacher talked about he doesn't want to be a Seventh-day Adventist. He wants to be a seven-day Adventist. With each day honoring God as the Sabbath. And so the title of the sermon was Seventh-day Adventist, not Seventh-day Adventist.
I see.
And I thought, oh, I don't want to get involved with that.
Yeah. No. Well, what is special about the Sabbath? What's special about your birthday?
It's a time to rest and reflect.
Mm-hmm.
There's an old Western song, Make the World Go Away, Take It Off My Shoulders. And that's the day that you can say to God, make the world go away, take it off of my shoulders, and just rest, and all your worries, you're just supposed to put in a basket that day and enjoy the day. Mm-hmm. And God will take care of the basket during the Sabbath. Like, what is the phrase, the Jews kept the Sabbath and God kept the Jews? So it's kind of, I heard that in an old movie I was watching. I thought, that's really interesting. Mm. And so if you do honor God, it just seems like things get fixed.
If we look at the history of Sabbath keeping down to the generations, We tend to see two extremes. Either there's a very, very strict Sabbath observance, like we've talked about the Pharisees. And then on the other side, there are times when the Sabbath is very casual, and we seem to be moving in that direction now. Hey, yeah, okay, fine, it's a nice day. And da-da. Where's the middle ground in all of that?
Well, you know, God wants us to meet and have time with Him, because in the wilderness, Jesus went in the wilderness, what, for 40 days. Moses was with the sheep sort of in the wilderness, and Who else was in the wilderness? So isn't it sort of our little weekly wilderness experience?
Talking about Elijah.
Yes.
So quite some time down.
And so God seems to call out people to just sort of be with Him.
Mm-hmm. The most, we're going to comment?
Regarding what John just said about the wilderness aspect of it, I thought like that too, but then I learned that it should be a lot of the, we should be do things corporately on the Sabbath also, mm-hmm. like fellowship and this and that. I used to ask my mom, why can't I just stay here?
Well, I think, we sometimes are in a modern world and people drive us nuts. Yeah. We get so much of that during the week. I really like to have the wilderness experience. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Well, let me ask you a tough question. How would you compare the way the average Seventh-day Adventist observes the Sabbath today with the way the Jews kept it in Jesus' day?
Subsequent generation, I know in my lifetime, I've seen it gradually slide.
Mm-hmm.
That might be a little rough a word, but
our
grandparents had a totally different look at it to what's around today.
It depends on the group. There are some wonderful, conservative, very conscientious, loving youth.
Mm-hmm.
And that are an inspiration to us older people who maybe have gotten slack. And so it just depends. It just depends.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We can't say it's all gone to...
Have you ever tried to sit down and make a list of the things that it's safe to do, holy things to do on the Sabbath?
No.
It's changed with the years.
Mm-hmm.
How far could you wade in the water?
Mm-hmm.
Those things.
You know, I wasn't brought up an Adventist, so I just don't relate to this, because coming into the church today, I don't see any of that, so.
Yeah. In your thinking, which thing is most important to celebrate on the Sabbath? The creation? Redemption out of Egypt? The redemption from sin, or the saving from sin that happened at Calvary? Or the idea that we're going to celebrate with God in the future in heaven?
Wow. They're all important.
Wow.
All important.
Can you separate them?
Yeah.
Why do you suppose God chose a 24-hour period to celebrate instead of, well, Muslims have a black stone, don't they?
Well, my nephew, he's not an Adventist, he says, the Adventists have it right, that the next day does start in the evening. If you don't get a good rest and a good night's sleep, the next day can be horrible. If you get a good night's sleep, the next day can be wonderful. There is a lot of importance in those hours where you need to sleep. Mm-hmm. So I think that's why it has to take in all 24 hours, rather than like some of the Sunday people just rush up to the time they go to church, and then continue to rush, and there's no thought of resting the 24 hour or the hours before the dawn.
Well, a special challenge for Adventists or anyone who wants to faithfully keep the Sabbath is what to do with children, especially young children. Got any suggestions?
The devil works the hardest on Sabbath.
The devil works the hardest on Sabbath.
For mothers, anyway.
Yes. Yeah.
Sure. And fathers.
I noticed you weren't defending the mothers, you were defending, and vice versa. What do we do about, is it possible to make the Sabbath a true delight, as it says in Isaiah 58, for children?
It wasn't for me.
It wasn't.
I think it takes a lot of work. And you can't really ignore it. You've got to start early.
Mm. I know a family that, where the son is no longer an Adventist. But that son grew up in a family where Adventists, and the parents always try to do things with the children on Sabbath. And when if you ask him, what do you remember about your childhood? I remember the Sabbath afternoons.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Train a child, and when he grows old, he will return.
Well, anyone who studied ancient Judaism in any detail knows that there were a multitude of rules for keeping the Sabbath. Surely all of us recognize that the Jews were particularly careful, maybe overly careful, in Sabbath keeping. They were constantly accusing Jesus of breaking their rules about the Sabbath. I mean, why couldn't Jesus just have cooperated? What were their Sabbath rules? Many of those rules have been preserved in a Jewish volume called the Mishnah. The Oxford University Press produced an English translation of the Mishnah, which gives us some of those details. First, however, note that in giving the fourth commandment, God said simply, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. In it thou shalt not do any work." But he did not tell them what work was. He didn't tell them even what he had in mind regarding work. So the Jews had to set about to solve that problem. So if you look in the volume on the Mishnah, page 106, it will say this. The main classes of work are 40, save one. Now, think about your own practices. How many of these rules are you violating on the Sabbath? Do you know any of these things on the Sabbath? Sowing, plowing, reaping, binding sheaves, threshing, winnowing, remember our story about the apostles, the disciples, cleansing crops, grinding, sifting, kneading, baking, shearing wool. Have any of you done that recently?
I'm safe so far.
You're safe so far, okay. Washing or beating or dyeing it. Do you wash or beat or dye your wool on the Sabbath? Spinning, weaving, making two loops, weaving two threads, separating two threads, tying a knot, loosening a knot, sewing two stitches. If the button fell off the pastor's suit on the way to church, if he does not want to look tidy, if he does want to look tidy in the pulpit, it is too bad that he cannot sew it on, because that would take more than two loops, right? Tearing in order to sew two stitches, hunting a gazelle. Have any of you done that on the Sabbath? I've hunted a gazelle with my camera. Slaughtering or flaying or salting it or curing its skin, scraping it or cutting it up, writing two letters. Uh-oh, I'm in real trouble now. Erasing in order to write two, does this include computers?
It doesn't say so.
Erasing in order to write two letters, building, pulling down, putting out a fire, lighting a fire, striking with a hammer, and taking out ought from one domain into another. These are the main classes of work, 40 save one.
Now on the Sabbath, isn't that a day where you're supposed to just pretend that Jesus is around with everything you do, whether you're preparing a meal for your family or whether you're with your children? It's just you shouldn't do anything that, it just like Jesus is a guest in your life on that day, you know, maybe every day. But I know I read about a man who like would sit a chair next to his chair and just have a conversation with Jesus. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's the stuff. I mean, that kind of stuff is scary that you're reading. I mean, there's no way that in the modern world.
Well, this was to help the people keep the Sabbath. They'd gone through, you know, the view of the Jews was they went into captivity in Babylon because of not keeping the Sabbath and the laws. So then when they came back, you know, they had the rules to keep. And this was the delineation of in absolute terms.
God would then bless them.
Yeah.
So we would never go into captivity again.
That's right. Absolutely.
By the way, that book, the Mishnah, is about this big.
Yeah.
It's over 800 to 1,000
pages. 850 pages, something like that, yeah.
But you can't help but wonder, though, existence back in those times was work in all of its forms, just to get food in your mouth once a day. You wonder who the obsessive compulsive was that started this all off, because it had no real bearing on survival.
Well, these 39, and the footnote says, where right at the end of that list, the footnote says, these 39 acts of work are treated in various degrees of detail in chapters 11 and following. So what are the details? What if you were rushing home on Friday evening and you did not quite make it home and your donkey was still heavily laden or loaded? There's definitely a rule for that. If, and now I quote, if on the eve of the Sabbath, darkness overtook a man while he was on the way, he must give his purse to a Gentile. While it's still day, of course. You see, a Gentile was not going to be saved anyway, so let him carry things for you. And if there was no Gentile with him, he must put it on the ass, that is, of course, the British term for donkey. When he has reached the outermost court of the town, he may take off from the ass such baggage as can be taken off on the Sabbath.
Now, you know, which baggage is that?
You know, that's got to be spelled out somewhere. And for what cannot be taken off on the Sabbath, he may loosen the cords so that the sacks may fall down of themselves. You don't want to have to leave your donkey with those sacks stuck on his back for 24 hours. The donkey will die. That's Mishnah page 120. Well, what about if you have dental pain? Suppose you have teeth that are making you very uncomfortable. If his, and now I'm quoting again, if his teeth pain him, he may not suck vinegar through them, but he may take vinegar after his usual fashion. And happy the man with sore teeth who is accustomed to taking vinegar in the usual fashion, because he may find relief. But one may not specially take vinegar on the Sabbath. Can you see why Jesus ran into trouble healing on the Sabbath? If a man is accustomed to taking vinegar in an ordinary way, he may do it. And if he is healed, he's healed. If his loins pain him, he may not rub thereon wine or vinegar, yet he may anoint them with oil, but not with rose oil. Now, king's children may anoint their wounds with rose oil, since it is their custom so to do on ordinary days. Mishnah, page 113.
Now, do these rules exist today?
Oh, well, they're
in some of them do, if you deal with orthodox Jews.
The real Orthodox Jews, yeah.
Oh, yeah. They will ask you to turn the light on and off and all. The new homes.
They won't ask.
They'll tell you.
No.
I've had it done.
According to what we're going to read,
they're not supposed to
ask. If you do it, they will use it.
Yeah.
But they don't tell you to.
What I remember, I've had both. Yeah. And usually it was.
Yeah, I've had people say, you know, not ask me to press the button for the elevator or push a floor, but when I press it on, they'll go on.
Jump right in, yeah.
It's well, I can tell you how that's done in some places. We were in Jerusalem, as I said, last summer.
Automatic.
We stayed in a very nice hotel that I think had 27 floors. And during the week, there were these cute little computer tarpa things. So when you walked up to use the elevator, you punched in the floor that you wanted to go to, and it would tell you which elevator would be the quickest way to get to that floor. Great, wonderful. There were six elevators, I think, across there. No problem. But on the Sabbath, four elevators for Gentiles and two elevators for Jews. So what do you suppose is different about the elevators for Jews?
Stopped at every floor, probably.
Everywhere.
Not quite. One elevator stopped at every odd floor, and the other elevator stopped in every even floor. And you could get on, the door would open, you get in, you don't have to push anything, you ride up, you stop at every floor, but you get to your floor eventually and you get off.
In bringing it closer to home, new homes here, fully Orthodox Jews, when they build them from scratch, they have two complete kitchens in one kitchen. They divide up their diet along certain ways it mentions in the Bible, and then everything is automatic on Friday and Sabbath. Friday, you know, the lights go on and off, they touch nothing.
Well, do you think God appreciates people going overboard trying to keep the Sabbath? Or what about people going underboard keeping the Sabbath,
let me read a few more rules and see what you think. If a Gentile came to put out the fire, they may not say to him, put it out, or do not put it out, since they are not answerable for his keeping Sabbath. But if it was a minor, that's a young person, that came to put it out, they may not permit him, since they are answerable for his keeping Sabbath. So even if it's a minor, you can't tell him to do something because you're, as an adult, responsible for what he does. Well, were there other things that Gentile might do for him, like lighting a lamp or filling a trough? Well, if a Gentile lighted a lamp, an Israelite may make use of the light, but if he lighted it for the sake of the Israelite, that is forbidden. If he filled a trough with water to give his cattle to drink, an Israelite may give his own cattle to drink after him. But if the Gentile did it for the Israelite, it is forbidden. If he made a gangway by which to come down from a ship, an Israelite may come down after him, but if he did it for the Israelite, it is forbidden.
But these are God's chosen people. God chose these people.
One of the most unusual rules is about bathing on the Sabbath and drying off. If a man bathed in the water of a cave or in the water of Tiberias, that would be the Sea of Galilee, and dried himself, even though it was with 10 towels, he may not bring them away in his hand. Why not? You might wonder, is that some? Well, there's a footnote. From fear of offending against the principle of squeezing out however little the moisture in them. So it's against the Sabbath rules to squeeze out any moisture. And you see why. What is important? You're not allowed to squeeze a towel on the Sabbath. But you want to dry yourself off. Well, use 10 towels and none of them will get very wet and you will not be by mistake squeeze them. But no, that's forbidden. So the rule goes on like this. But if 10 men dried themselves with one towel, then it would be very wet, wouldn't it? Wiping their faces, their hands, and their feet, they may bring the towel away in their hands. And you say, well, how could that possibly be? Well, the footnote goes on, so many, this is 10 now altogether, so many would keep each other warned of the danger of squeezing. Yeah. It's Mishnah, page 119. What do you think? Would it be safer for them to, 10 people to use the same towel? You squeeze less water out of the towel?
Sanitary.
What about a Sabbath day's journey? We're about to run out of time. A Sabbath day's journey was about a half a mile, roughly. Well, but what if you had a home that was a half a mile away? Could you go there and then you take a couple bites of meat or something like that and then you go another half mile, right? Well, how much home do you have to have? Could you have a tent that you set up on Friday? Or maybe just a lunch stowed under a bush. Well, how did Jesus observe the Sabbath? And we're not going to have time to read all this. He gathered with believers. He talked about nature. He saw the Galilean countryside. He relieved human suffering. He rested from work. We may imply that he refrained from merchandising. We may also infer from Jesus' disciples' conduct that he observed the preparation day and so forth. Well, in all of this, I think we've got an idea why Jesus did what he did on the Sabbath. He intentionally broke those very, what we would regard as foolish rules, but at the same time, he carefully observed the true meaning of the Sabbath as he understood it. Do we? Thank you.